Good morning, everybody. Welcome to you from wherever you are watching from this morning. Today in our Bible reading, we'll hear about two friends who have an unexpected encounter with Jesus and initially react in very different ways. Together, Philip and Nathanael help each other to understand who Jesus is, and they begin a journey that will define who they are. Nathanael is surprised that Jesus knows not only his name, but much more about him too. Jesus knows each of us as individuals, but sometimes, like Nathanael, we can wonder, why would God be interested in me? Some of us will be, like Philip, keen to follow straight away. Some of us will be more like Nathanael, full of questions and concerns. Our Bible story today shows that wherever we are, Jesus finds us and knows us. The question is, are we looking and listening out for him and helping others to do so too? I invite you to join me in saying together an opening prayer. Almighty God, you speak to us in so many ways. Help us in our worship today to hear your voice and know it is you. Speak to us in the silence, through scripture and by the Spirit. Speak through others and through your creation, through images, experiences, music, and encounters. Speak in ways that we can understand. So speak, Lord, and help us to listen. Amen. Before we move on, I just invite you to pause for a moment and spend some time in quiet and stillness. Some images will appear on the screen, and as we look at the images, I invite you to think about what circumstances or environment helps you to see or hear God. What are the things that get in the way? And how might we help each other to look and listen for God? Continuing on that theme, our first hymn today is Be Still, for the presence of the Lord, the Holy One is here. Let's sing together.
Thank you.
Our reading today comes from John's Gospel, chapter 1, verses 43 to 51, and is read by Tom.
The reading is from John chapter 1, verses 43 to 51. Jesus calls Philip and Nathanael. The next day, Jesus decided to leave for Galilee. Finding Philip, he said to him, "Follow me." Philip, like Andrew and Peter, was from the town of Bethsaida. Philip found Nathanael and told him, "We have found the one Moses wrote about in the law, and about whom the prophets also wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph." "Nazareth? Can anything good come from there?" Nathanael asked. "Come and see," said Philip. When Jesus saw Nathanael approaching, he said of him, "Here truly is an Israelite in whom there is no deceit." "How do you know me?" Nathanael asked. Jesus answered, "I saw you while you were still under the fig tree before Philip called you." Then Nathanael declared, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." Jesus said, "You believe because I told you I saw you under the fig tree. You will see greater things than that." He then added, "Very truly, I tell you, you will see heaven open and the angels of God ascending and descending on the Son of Man."
Thank you, Tom. One of the best films that I watched this last Christmas, one that's been repeated many times before, was The Best Exotic Marigold Hotel. If you haven't seen it, it's about a group of British retired people who travel to India to take up residence in what they believe is a newly restored hotel. Far less luxurious than advertised, the Marigold Hotel slowly begins to charm in unexpected ways. It has such a great cast, with household names such as Judy Dench, Maggie Smith, Bill Nighy, Penelope Wilton, and Celia Imrie making up the group. But it's Maggie Smith's character, Muriel Donnelly, that I find the most interesting. A former housekeeper, she arrives in Jaipur for a cheaper hip operation and then convalesces at the exotic Marigold Hotel. There's little that Muriel likes about India, but what she likes least is the food. On the journey to the hotel, she's offered something to eat, which Bill Nighy's character describes as a luka paratha. With her acid tongue, Muriel replies, "If I can't pronounce it, I don't want to eat it." Her refusal to eat the dishes lovingly made and brought to her each day as she recovers from surgery reflect her stubborn refusal to experience anything new. Her character, I think, expresses well the natural human suspicion we have of things we don't know. Rather than try something new, many of us instinctively believe we won't like it, so reject it out of hand, even if, in reality, it could do us some good. Faced with something new, we find ourselves saying, "I don't like it," before even asking, "What is it?" Nathanael's response to Philip in John 1, verse 46, "Nazareth, can anything good come from there?" falls very close to this kind of saying. Nathanael knows it to be a self-evident truth that nothing and no one good comes from Nazareth. It's interesting to ask why he might think that. What was so bad about Nazareth? Nathanael's saying trips off his lips, a little like Muriel's in the film. This is no new prejudice, but one well ingrained. The problem is that it's hard for those of us who know nothing of the basis of Nathanael's dislike to know where it came from. There are two main options. One is that since Nathanael came from Cana, a neighbouring village to Nazareth, there may have been some historic ill feeling between the two, not dissimilar to that which exists between some Fenland villages. The problem is that if there was, this is the only evidence we have of it. A second possibility, and this might interest the historians among you, is that Nazareth, like the whole of Galilee, was seen as completely the wrong place for the Messiah, who was thought to come from Judea, the southern kingdom, and specifically from Bethlehem. It's worth noting that Galilee in the north had only relatively recently become part of the Jewish nation again. After the northern kingdom fell in 722 BC, the Assyrians mixed up the population, and for all intents and purposes, the northern kingdom, as it had existed before then, came to an end. But during the period of the Maccabees, late 2nd century BC, Galilee was brought back into the Jewish nation. As a result, Jews from Judea, which had always been Jewish, regarded Galilee suspiciously, and certainly not the place that the Messiah would come from. Of course, the problem with this is that Nathanael was also from Galilee. If this is what he meant, there may have been some certain sarcasm behind his question. As with so many of these issues, we will never probably know what Nathanael had against Nazareth. The real point of the story is what happened next. Nathanael expressed a view steeped in prejudice, whether of his own or one more widely held, and Philip simply responded with the words, "Come and see. Come and see. Come see for yourself." Philip's invitation to Nathanael was to leave behind the track upon which he was set and look again at what he knew to be true. Of course, the outcome was an encounter with Jesus, where Nathanael realised not only that something good could indeed come out of Nazareth, but that it had in the person of Jesus. This passage illustrates that it's not just a lack of curiosity which prevents us from engaging deeper in our faith. Sometimes, as was the case with Nathanael, it can be prejudice. Or to put it more gently, knowing already that something is the case so that we don't need to investigate further. So often our minds are so firmly set on a certain course that we cannot see beyond it. We don't intend to be closed-minded. We simply don't expect to find anything good in a certain place, so we don't. On occasions like this, we need someone like Philip to challenge us to think again, to look beyond what we know to be true and to see it with fresh eyes. Sometimes, turning aside to see how God might be calling or speaking to us comes naturally, but sometimes we need help. Sometimes we need the intervention of someone like Philip, who's able to come alongside us and suggest that we might come and see, before we decide too firmly that what is over there simply cannot be of God. Indeed, the challenge of faithful Christian living is being open to the Philips we meet along the way, who invite us to come and see. The Philips we meet along the way might not always be right, but if we decide that before going to see, we risk missing an encounter with the one who knows everything about us. Nathanael's encounter with Jesus was particularly remarkable as he moves from doubting that anything good can come from Nazareth, thereby questioning that this Jesus whom Philip is so excited about could be anyone special, to being one of the first to express belief in Jesus Christ as the Son of God. In conversation with Jesus, he discovers that Jesus knows far more about him than he expected. Jesus acknowledges Nathanael as truly an Israelite, living in God's shalom, God's peace, where each one has their own vine and fig tree. The change is extraordinary as Nathanael heaps Jesus with titles: Israel's King, God's Son. And with that, Jesus promises Nathanael much more, that he'll see great things, you will see heaven open, and the angels of God ascending and descending on the Son of Man. What a promise for a man who was initially so dismissive of Jesus being the one Moses wrote about in the law and about whom the prophets also wrote. If Nathanael didn't believe that Philip's claims of Jesus being the promised Messiah were true, all it took was for him to respond to Philip's invitation to come and see, to find out for himself that Jesus was indeed the Son of God. It's easy to allow ourselves to be blinded by stereotypes of places, people or things. Perhaps there's a little bit of the Muriel Donnelly in all of us. But if we do, then we miss the wonder and the beauty waiting to be discovered. Maybe there are areas of discipleship that we instinctively dismiss, saying that they're definitely not for us. We might turn down invitations to join a Bible study group, or reject suggestions to take up a daily reading of the Bible, maybe with notes, or keeping a prayer journal. But until we try something new, we never know what benefit we might gain. So today, is there something to which God is prompting you to say yes? Or it may be that you're being called to be a Philip to someone on the edge of faith, someone who maybe comes to the occasional service, perhaps at Christmas, but doesn't come back, maybe thinking that Christianity isn't for them. If God has placed someone's name on your heart, prompting you to make contact and be the one, like Philip, who encourages someone to come and see, then maybe today is the day to make that call. Like in the case of Nathanael, what a difference you could make. As a response to God's word, I invite you to join me in a prayer of confession. When I say Father, would you respond with, forgive us. Lord, we come before you to say sorry. Sorry for the times that we've closed our minds to the different ways in which you speak to us, one being through other people. Help us to take notice rather than just continuing on our way. Forgive us our prejudices that refuse to see your wonder and beauty in the places, people, and things around us. Father, forgive us. Lord, as you use others to speak to us, so you use us to draw people to you. But speaking does not always require words. People see our lives, our attitudes, and our character. Lord, we are sorry for the times we've let you down in these areas, when we pressurize others to conform to our ideas, or fail to listen and give others the space to draw closer to you. Father, forgive us. May God, our Father, forgive us our sins and bring us to the eternal joy of his kingdom. Amen. Our next hymn is that beautiful hymn by Keith and Christine Getty, Holy Spirit, Living Breath of God. I so love the words, cause your word to come alive in me. Give me faith for what I cannot see. Words that are so relevant in these difficult times. Let's join together and sing. Martin will now lead us in a time of prayer.
When I say, Lord, hear our prayer, could you respond with, and draw us closer to you? Come and see, and join in praying for the people of the world waiting to hear good news. Loving God, we pray for the states of America to be united in the days and weeks ahead. We pray for an end to violence, for wisdom and protection for President-elect Joe Biden and all who take office in a few days' time. We pray for those threatening to disrupt the inauguration and for the police force and those entrusted with keeping the law and peace. Lord, hear our prayer and draw us closer to you. We pray for those around the world at the mercy of extreme weather conditions. We pray for the people of Japan, of Indonesia, especially for the families of the rescue workers who died trying to save others, for those who lost loved ones in the plane crash, and for those in our own country without power and heat and enough food to eat. We pray for those tackling the climate change challenges of our time and for our own response in our day-to-day lives. Lord, hear our prayer and draw us closer to you. We pray for all who are pushed to their limits at work and at home, for intensive care staff, for all in the emergency services, the GPs, and for all those whose mental health is at breaking point. We pray for our government and all whose decisions affect millions of lives, and we pray for one another as we respond to the restrictions locally and nationally. Lord, hear our prayer and draw us closer to you. We pray for children and young adults as their schooling is disrupted. We pray for those who enjoy learning from home. Pray too for those who will lose confidence, who miss their friends, who feel vulnerable. We remember their parents and the parents of children with special needs, struggling to cope on their own. We pray for teachers, support and administrative staff, and all those who feel overwhelmed. Lord, hear our prayer and draw us closer to you. We pray for those whose businesses are closed, whose shops are locked up, whose rooms have no guests, for those whose money is running out, for those on the brink of despair. Lord, hear our prayer and draw us closer to you. We pray for those who are unwell at the moment. We pray particularly for Rex Collinson, David Woodcroft and Peter Tilbury, all in hospital with COVID-19, and for Rona Gardner, Jean Wilmshurst, Bob Ward and Jonathan Johnson. May they all know your healing touch at this difficult time. We also pray for the families of Kay Wilson, Richard Gautry and William Hornet, who have recently died. May you bring your comfort to those who are grieving. Lord, hear our prayer and draw us closer to you. We pray for your church, entrusted with the good news of Jesus and charged with serving all those in need. We pray for hospital chaplains, for those ministering to the bereaved, and for one another as we seek to share our faith and our hope in Jesus Christ. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you for joining with us for worship today. I wonder what you've learned today about how God speaks to us and to other people, and how we can help or hinder that process. I wonder how you might put into practice throughout this next week what you've discovered. Remember that we have evening prayer through Zoom this evening at 6 p.m. Let me know if you'd like to join but don't have the link. And both Bible study groups on a Tuesday night and Friday afternoon have resumed. The Tuesday group alternates Bible study, looking at songs of praise in the Bible with Compline. And the Friday group is looking at the Old Testament. If you want to join either, please let me know and I'll happily send you the details. We end with a sending out prayer for the week ahead. Lord, what we have learned today, help us remember. Teach us to recognize your voice. Teach us how to see you in our lives and encounters. Help us to give others space so that they may hear you too. In Jesus' name, amen. Go in peace to love, serve, and enjoy the Lord. In the name of Christ, amen. Have a really good week and goodbye.